My name is Adam of Grayskull. When good is threatened by the power of Eternia, I was summoned to the future by the last of mankind to defend them in their hour of need. But my old enemy, Skeletor, followed me. Now, here in the future, he has found new allies to help him in his never-ending fight against all that is good. Yet on Primus, I too have found new brave friends and a new family. Thus, with the power of the good and the way of the magic, we struggle against the forces of darkness. Good against evil. The battle continues.
Hello, this is Optimus Solo, and welcome to the 94th chapter in our Powers of Grayskull series. With me for this journey into the Masters of the Universe franchise is the one and only TFG1Mike. Hello.
It just gets worse and worse.
I might differ with your opinion on that one.
This we'll week see. You might. Next week, let's hope not, because next week, oh my god.
I think something... Well, I'll talk about it in a little bit. So, mm-hmm. Are you ready for another trip to space?
No.
Okay. Well, regardless if you're ready or not, here we come. Because in this episode of Masters in Space, we'll be giving you our thoughts on the next three episodes of The New Adventures of He-Man. Episode 34, Zone of Darkness. Episode 35, Once Upon a Time, not the TV series. And episode 36, A Plague Upon Primus. So we hope you're ready, because it's time to go back to space.
This won't even be worth watching.
All right, first up today is episode 34, Zone of Darkness. Air date September 21st, 1990. Written by Jim Carlson and Terrence McDonnell. Another two new names that we have not seen before, I don't believe. And basically, Master Sebrian and Mara crash in a remote area of Denebria, and He-Man hurries to their rescue, and in the crash place, he is welcomed by mutants who are behaving unusually friendly. They say that they were once humans. So... this is an interesting episode where he's encountering mutants that claim to be humans, and we also have the dichotomy of, are they working for the mutants, or are they actually good? So it's kind of like a trust episode. Can we trust these guys or not? So what did you think about this one?
I liked it. It was okay. Skeletor, he's a little late to make a Transformers reference, but okay. I don't know. At first it stood out to me like, oh, this is your standard, you know, we're just, you know, misunderstood, yada yada yada. Someone has said so many things about us, but none of it's true. That kind of thing. And the whole, like, oh, we've come to this planet and we were gonna explore it or whatever, and it turned us into evil creatures or evil looking creatures, and then hey. We go back to Primus, and the three sons cure us. I'm like, really? Seriously? That's the plot?
You know, I haven't had a chance to do the research yet. So, you know, if there's a listener out there or a super fan that wants to fill me in, please do, or I'll try to find out by the end of the series. But I swear something happened at the halfway mark with this series. Like, a different team of some sort came in. I know I already kind of talked about this last episode or the one before, but it seems like right when we got to episode... I don't know, 30-ish, mm-hmm. Like, all of a sudden, something was different. Like, I don't know if it's the director, or if it's the creative team, or what, but I don't, do you feel that way? I feel like the episodes are different.
Yeah, it's not, I don't think it's this batch of episodes, it's next week's where... I'll go ahead and say this now, and I'll repeat myself next week, because everybody knows I repeat myself all the damn time. Because I just repeat myself all the damn time. Right. It's one of those things where what I noticed in the next week's batch, in episode 95, is the transformation scene changed. It's longer now. I'm like, really? Seriously? It's longer? I think one of these... producers, whomever, animators went back and watched Thundercats, because he's like swinging this and swinging that. I'm like, no, you're not Lionel. Go away, 90s New Adventures He-Man. No.
Yeah, but I'll get into it a little bit more when we get into our good and bad moments. But I swear there's multiple things from a visual standpoint, from who's getting the more time on screen, from some of the relationships between the characters, and the quality of the episodes seemed like they changed all of a sudden. So it's weird. It's like the second half has started off really more positive than I expected. And we'll see how long that lasts, but at least, you know, last week we were super positive on it, and I'm going to be pretty positive overall today too. So it's just a strange, I feel like I'm on this planet. I don't know who to trust here. Do I trust these episodes? Are they good, or are they going to be mutants once we get to know them a little bit more? So, let's take a quick break and we'll come back with the good, the bad, the ugly, and some rewards and awards and ratings and all kinds of fun stuff.
Wake me when it's over. I'm going to get my beauty sleep.
All right, let's start with some good and bad moments for this episode. What did you like about this first one today?
I like the fact, but I'm also annoyed at the fact that they throw the whole message of, you know, look with your eyes, look with your heart, look on the inside. Like, have we not had this enough in other 90s properties? Have we not had this enough in 80s properties? Like, come on already.
I'm going to jump in along with this because this is my only Snake Mountain moment. But this seems to be like the one theme or the one like message, PSA type quality thing that nobody can do subtly. Like, it always is so forceful, so hit you over the head, so hammer it home. Like, every time we've seen this in a cartoon, it seems like they have to have a line or a dialogue that, like, just outright says stuff like, you know, you can't judge someone on their appearance, or, you know, it's what's inside that counts, or whatever. And it's like, you can just show us, like, through the story. You don't have to tell us on top of it.
And that's the thing, like, several of the Filmation episodes, both He-Man and She-Ra, have a message in the episode, and then they still have the PSA at the end. I get it was the 80s, Lou Scheimer needed to have the PSAs, I understand that, that's fine, we've already gone through that in the last 5.5 years at this point, and all of that, but the same thing here, like, this show still has PSAs, and I don't know if it's because of the fact that whomever the executives are, we're trying to emulate Filmation, but like, some of the PSAs make like, there was one PSA I watched within this episode's batch or next week's episode batch, because I watched all six at once. Where it felt like a mask PSA, like, oh, hey, by the way, don't leave the oven on, kind of. Like, really, seriously, that's your PSA in 1990 or 1991 or 1992 or whatever that. Like, seriously? Like, The Simpsons had better PSA crap at this point. Like, I mean, come on!
That's why, as you've noticed, we haven't really talked about PSAs in this
Hell no.
We've given up on that. We're watching the episodes. That's as much as we can give you. We're not going to comment on the PSAs they have at the end.
The only way we're going to comment on PSAs is if people start paying us $50 each for episodes. I'm not kidding. You laugh. You think I'm kidding. I'll start charging people $50 an episode. No one's going to pay. And then they'll never get released. But seriously, yeah.
What about any other good or bad moments for you?
Like I said earlier, Skeletor, oh, he must be more than meets the eye. I'm like, please, Optimus Prime, come in and bash this guy over the head.
I thought it was interesting that we have a thing where they're mutants, so, and they know that, so the bad guys will trust us because we look hideous type thing.
Yeah.
That was kind of an interesting switch, like, they were going to use their disguise to trick the bad guys. Why is Skeletor doing the jig at the beginning of this episode? That was hilarious. But he's, like, doing a song and dance at the beginning. And that's another thing. It's like, did somebody else take over? Because this is, even Skeletor's acting in ways that he didn't during the first half, I feel like.
Yeah.
And the other big thing that we all of a sudden are seeing here in the second half of this series is, was there a new introduction in the toy line? I don't know if there was the toy line for this series or not. I assume there was.
There was. What killed the franchise, actually, I think.
But at this point, was there a big introduction of vehicles that were sold alongside the action figures in the same vein of vehicles that you would have seen in, like, G.I. Joe and stuff like that?
That's something that you're going to have to research when we do the recap, because I have no idea. At 1990, 1991, I was ready for The Simpsons. Like I've already said, back in episode 83 of the podcast, I had nothing, like, once they took away Filmation He-Man stuff on toy shelves, I was full on Transformers, Simpsons, Turtles, had knew nothing of this toy line.
But have you noticed that all of a sudden we're seeing, like, yeah, a bunch of vehicles in the episodes that are, like, yeah, one-man vehicles or two-person vehicles? Like, there's, yep, ground vehicles, there's and they look exactly like what you would have seen, like, with a like mask vehicle without the transformation aspect, or like a G.I. Joe vehicle or something like that. It's yeah, weird. It's out of nowhere, because we never saw that during the first half outside of the main spaceships that we see.
Yeah, at least in this case with the Astro subs,
mm-hmm,
they're not sky sled-ish, where it's, yeah, just somebody sitting on a toboggan or something. It's actually somebody in a TIE fighter X-wing type thing, whatever.
Yeah, but it's not even just in this episode. Like, if you start watching from, like, episode whatever, 29, mm-hmm, 30, something like that, all of a sudden you start seeing a bunch of vehicles popping up here and there, so that's kind of interesting. I like Sagittar and Tuscador, mm-hmm, way more than Flipshot and Hydran.
Yeah, I'll have more to say about Flipshot next week, because, oh my god, as much as I love Scott McNeil, whoever the hell is writing episodes for Flipshot needs to be flipped over and shot.
So basically this episode has taken out Flipshot and Hydran as the main characters, and instead we have Sagittar and Tuscador as, like, the main characters. And we've seen that a couple different times here now, again, towards the second half, where, yeah, they're inserting more of the other Galactic Guardians. And I love the look of Sagittar and Tuscador better. I like their attitudes better. They're highlighted in this week's episode, and you'll see why maybe Flipshot and Hydran are not highlighted when we get to next week's episode. Mm. But that's all I had for that. So what about any Havoc Staff or Power Swords for you?
Power Swords to Skeletor and He-Man. I thought they both had interesting moments and all that. The other negative thing I had really quickly, I forgot to mention,
mm-hmm,
I don't mind them showing the sorceress in He-Man's eye and all that, but did we really need the echoing effect on different than perceived, like, no, don't do that. Don't do that. Wow. Yeah, but He-Man and Skeletor get power swords. What about you? Any ratings? Or not any awards?
Yeah, I just have power swords for Tuscador and Sagittar, because I'd like to see them more and the other guys less. Mm-hmm. So that's all I had for rating-wise. I am at a 3.5 on this one. I think it's above average. I think there's a little bit uniqueness as far as we don't get to see this a lot, where you just run into a different race and you have to figure out if they're good or bad. And there's a scene, literally a scene of them talking with Skeletor and the mutants making a deal. So you think that they are, but they're really not. And they're really humans that were just kind of turned into these beings by being on this planet. The only thing that I was kind of waiting for was, it did turn Severian and everybody back to humans. I was waiting to see what these guys would have looked like when they turned back to humans, but they didn't. I don't know if they just needed longer, or if their effects were more permanent, but I thought it was above average. I'm 3.5. What about you?
I'm right there with you. It's 3.5. It's average, bordering on good. I think if, right, the not necessarily the execution, but if the plot was done a little, like, rewritten just a little bit to show, like, okay, so remember when I'm sure you remember, everybody remembers, go back to episode 83 of Powers of Grayskull series here, and when we started the New Adventures of He-Man, the first thing I said was, in that very first episode, it took them 8.5 minutes to tell us anything about He-Man out of a 22-minute cartoon. You could have taken 8.5 minutes here to give us a story. Like, I'm basically reversing my position. Yes, you could show Primus and what, like, mm-hmm, Primus could say, oh, we've noticed this planet out here that's in trouble or whatever. Cut to the planet, have some sort of dialogue or some sort of explanation, whatever the hell you want to call it, to explain to the audience these people's plight and, like, have more backstory on them in one 22-minute episode than just, oh, we look different, so we're uglier, so we're assuming that, oh, all mutants are evil, yada, 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 yada. I'm like, oh my god, no.
But a fairly positive way to start today with 2 3.5, so it could have been worse for sure. We'll take a break and see if it gets better or worse from here.
Mm-hmm.
Wait in war for all the power in the universe.
Now it's your turn. Give it up, Skeletor. I've got He-Man, the most powerful man in the universe. Come on, He-Man. Go!
specially marked packages and get a mutant-free figures and vehicles sold separately.
Up next today is episode 35, Once Upon a Time, written by Misty Taggart, also aired in 1990. He-Man, suffering from homesickness after being away from Eternia for so long, begs the sorceress for a chance to go back home. Instead, the sorceress sends his old friend Tila from Eternia to join him in the future. Skeletor, meanwhile, finds a volume of the Encyclopedia of Evil. With the entire encyclopedia, he would be unbeatable, so he travels to the Vault of Zactus, where he assumes the other volumes of the encyclopedia would be.
Uh-huh. Okay.
What do you think, sir? A flash to Eternia, and a character that we have known from previous series enters into the new adventures.
I mean, I was waiting for her and Mara to just jump in a pit of pudding or something, because, oh my god, Mara in this episode... Mara's been annoying in the past. She's not as annoying as Filmation Tila was, but damn, this episode, pretty much, it was... New Adventures Tila with Filmation Tila. Like, Mara took the place of Filmation. Like, no. Oh, my God.
Did you like this Tila better than the other Tila?
I think they took too many liberties. I think they tried to make her more Adora-ish, except they gave her Prince Adam's pink stuff from... like, her look reminds me of a cross between... If you took Prince Adam... And you took Princess Allura from Voltron in the pink Voltron. So that's essentially what this Tila is as far as her look and all that, as far as her outfit goes. I don't know. I liked it. I thought it was interesting that she obviously knows Adam. She knows He-Man. But she has more of a friendship with He-Man than she does Adam. Like, go back 5 years or whatever to when we covered Filmation. That was more of a brother-sister thing with that Adam and Tila. Like, she's always giving him shit and whatever else and all this and all that and everything else. But this seems to be more like, hey, I could be your wife someday. I don't know.
The other thing that's kind of weird... well, first of all, I do enjoy the fact that we're getting a connection to Eternia. Like,
I
would enjoy more of those.
Absolutely.
It's like, though, that they went out of their way to try to be as different as possible with the character designs. Like they wanted to distance themselves from Filmation, or maybe they wanted to make sure that they didn't get, you know, sued or something. I don't know what the situation was, but, like, you could at least take something of the original one and bring it over. Like, as some aspect that would remind you of the old characters, but,
Yeah. Like
you said, they look nothing like each other. Like, you have enough... Like, Sorceress has some stuff that's similar. Like, she looks different, but... You could tell by looking at her that she is the sorceress.
Yeah.
He-Man looks different, but you can look at him and know that he's He-Man. Skeletor's really weird, but you could look at him and still kind of figure out that he's Skeletor. But if you look at Tila, you don't know that she's Tila. Mm-mm. Like, you'd be like, is this She-Ra? Is this somebody else? Like, who is this? But, of course, it is Tila. The other thing that's weird, though, I guess did a good job of not even acknowledging so that nobody thought about it, but there would have to be some type of weird situation where Tila finds that both He-Man and Adam are on this distant planet.
Yeah.
And not just one of them. Yeah. Like, that would be a key giveaway that they're the same person. But I like that aspect of this episode. I could care less about the Encyclopedia of Evil.
Oh, my God. Like, okay, so...
It's fun because it gives Skeletor some comedic moments, but...
Yeah.
I care more about the Tila He-Man aspect.
Yep.
Anything else.
The thing about Skeletor and his design now, it's not... It's better than what the original, first five episode design was. I've come to like it because he's... You put a damn 10-gallon hat on him, and he's basically a dancing cowboy with those pants. I mean, seriously, I mean, I've come around to Skeletor's look, and it's okay. But yeah, Tila,
not that there's anything wrong with her look. You just wouldn't know that that's who's.
Yeah, exactly.
Is.
Yeah.
It probably would have been a better look if that was the look from the beginning. Heck, I mean, Filmation one wasn't incredible or anything like that, but.
Yeah.
All right, let's take a quick break. We'll come back and get more into this episode, what we like, what we didn't like, and you'll see how we decided this one rated, the Eternia Connection.
Thank you for calling P-Harmony, the service that matches you with the podcast that best fits your interests and needs.
I really hope you could help me because I have had no luck finding the perfect movie podcast that gives me everything that I want.
Well, that's my job. What are you looking for in a podcast?
Well, it needs to be a movie podcast that covers old and new stuff, one that reviews movies but also talks about movie news, discusses new trailers, and is willing just to have fun with some crazy movie games. Maybe even, you know, like the occasional top 10 countdown. Oh, and it's got to be a podcast that is willing at times to delve deep into the careers of notable directors and will speak to all movie fans, from the general audience to the hardcore cinephile.
Wow, well, that's quite a resume you're looking for. What are you thinking regarding schedule? Monthly, weekly, daily?
Weekly, of course.
All right, well, let me crunch these numbers in our patented podcast matrix to see what I can find for you. Wow, I don't believe it.
What is it?
We actually found the perfect match. This almost never happens.
Really? Well, dreams do come true. What is it?
It is the Cinema Geeks podcast, of course.
Well, that sounds perfect, but where can I hook up with such an awesome podcast?
Well, you can find it weekly on iTunes, Blog Talk Radio, or GeekCastReader.com.
Awesome. Podcast marathon, here I come.
Another satisfied customer brought to you by P-Harmony and the folks over at the Cinema Geeks podcast.
All right, we're back to get a little bit more onto this Once Upon a Time episode. I got a couple things here. Actually, I have about three or four items for both, so I'll go first and you can talk about whatever's left. The good moments here. I love the idea that He-Man actually misses Eternia, because up to this point, it's like he didn't even exist in Eternia. Like, he's made no acknowledgement that he was from another planet, no desire to go back there, no, like, oh, we got to finish this up so I can return to my, you know, family. There's been no mention of it. So it's good that we're acknowledging that he is not from this planet and is gone from the planet he grew up on. Nordor? Is that coming straight out of Lord of the Rings?
I assume so.
That's not the first or last time we're going to hear that either.
No.
I was definitely very positive on the fact that Tila's involved here. I did find it funny, though, that at the end of the episode, you know, obviously the sorceress made this happen, but Tila doesn't just say bye or we'll see you again sometime. She says farewell forever.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that was odd. Like, so you guys are just acknowledging that you're never going to see each other no matter what again? Like, I thought that was... I didn't think that was in the cards. I thought at some point they wanted to reunite. At some point, He-Man might want to go home after this is all said and done, but I guess not.
Guess not.
Snake Mountain. Mara is a jealous bitch.
Mm-hmm.
Why did the ground go back together perfectly? Like, they created this big chasm, and then it's just going to come back together and line up and just smooth out and fit perfectly. That's not how science works, or physics. And why is Ram Man a bad guy in this episode? Or in this series? Like, I don't know. Like,
yeah, that makes no sense.
And then also, He-Man literally destroyed a tree and then threw it in the path of Butthead. I still can't believe there's a character named Butthead.
And where's Beavis when you really need him?
And how does the tree stop Butthead? Like, just go around it.
Yeah, really.
Or Ram Man. I'm going to call him Ram Man because I don't like calling him Butthead. What about you? Good or bad moments?
I already said it earlier. Tila's back and looking very Prince Adamish with all that pink. This might be the most evil Skeletor has done yet. We see that he's feeling like he needs to take over from Flog, so I like that part.
It's another aspect that they've kind of gone away from. As far as he being a subordinate. Like, there's a lot more episodes where he's just in charge and he doesn't ask for permission these days.
Because there are some episodes where he's like, we will take over. Like, yeah.
Right.
For bad moments, you're right. Mara's a jealous bitch, but the rhyming. Oh my god, the rhyming. No. Just no. No wheelie. Thank you very much.
Oh, I like wheelie. Anything else from you?
Nope, that's it.
All right, what about Hammock Staffs or Power Swords?
Havoc staff to Tila just on principle because it's Tila and Mara for being a jealous bitch in the beginning.
Interesting.
Power sword to Skeletor because it's Skeletor and This is very middle ground for me. So what about you for awards?
I have a Havoc staff for Mara as well. She was annoying. I also have a Havoc staff for the mutants because they definitely caused that cave-in, and they should have been a little bit smarter than that. And a power sword for Tila because I enjoyed seeing the Eternian connection. I think I'm going to be a little bit more positive on this episode. What kind of rating do you have on this one?
3. It's very middle ground. It's not good, not bad. It's not super horrible, but, you know.
See, I didn't care necessarily for the storyline with the Encyclopedia of Evil, even though it let Skeletor do some funny things and be evil and whatnot. But I really did like the Eternia connection, the fact that he was missing it, and the fact that we got Tila. I would love seeing more characters. I know we're not going to, but I would love seeing like a Man at Arms or Orko or Battle Cat or anybody. But so we got Tila. Not my first choice, but it's still somebody. So I'm going to be at a 4 on this one. I enjoyed that aspect of it enough to give it a positive score. So, all right, we're going to take a quick break. Nothing negative yet. We'll see what happens in the next episode when we get into episode 36, A Plague Upon Primus.
Damn it, Unicron.
Last up today is episode 36 of Plague Upon Primus, written by David Bennett Caron and J. Larry Carroll. With the help of anxiety gas, Skeletor can change all men of Primus into trembling cowards. The gas has the opposite effect on the women of Primus and mutants. When the mutants attack, the women must defend their homeland. So we have a MacGuffin that's going to take all the men out of the equation, and it's going to be up to women and mutants to battle it out. What do you think?
It's very, equality rules, I guess. This whole episode, it felt like that old commercial, whatever men can do, women can do better kind of thing. And I get it. It's the plot of the episode. It's the fact that Skeletor has created this thing that he believes will destroy the entire planet because, and I'm sure in Skeletor's mind, he's a male chauvinist pig that doesn't think women can do anything. Of course, this was the 90s. Women were breaking out in the 90s. I mean, you know, She-Ra had her series in the 80s. Jam had her series in the 80s. There were plenty, I know Sailor Moon was big in the 90s. Sailor Moon's always been big, but specifically, I remember Sailor Moon in the 90s. That's all women kind of like. But this episode is like, really, that's what you're gonna do with it?
Honestly, this should have been the plot for last episode, and this should have been the benefit of Tila being around is that she would be able to help defend things and kind of save the day, but they didn't do that. So it's weird that you would have a plot one episode before where Tila's here, and then the next episode after Tila's gone, you're going to have one that they need women to defend themselves. So I don't know. So that would have been a better way to do things in my mind, but
yep.
This is not a type of plot that I'm going to get on board with. Like, why does this thing only work on men? Why are mutants and women immune? It's just too convenient. It's too contrived. I'm not a fan of the plot, so it would have
not
to be
at all.
Executed fairly well for me to enjoy this episode. So let's take a quick break and see if they did execute it well or if this one fell flat on its face.
The new He-Man Power Sword.
Cool! It makes sound!
That's all!
Skeletor!
The Power Sword makes 8 action sounds. It lights up with power. You can be a hero! With the He-Man Power Sword! Send for a He-Man video for 99 cents and postage with specially marked vehicles.
Alright, let's see if there's anything good about this episode. Mike, what do you think? Not a good sign.
Oh, Lord. I mean, I like that they're spotlighting women, but I think they're doing it in a very disjointed, wrong, incorrect kind of way. I think... this is so sad. I think what they tried to do is they tried to take the premise of Masters of the Universe and Princess of Power and meld them together, whereas in Masters of the Universe, the original Filmation series, most of the time it was the men doing all the work and the women not doing much, and then in She-Ra, it was all the women doing all the work and the men made to look like, you know, puny wimps. I think that's what they tried to do here, is combine both of those premises and make one episode, and they thought it was going to be good, and it's really not.
And I mean, contrived is about the only word I can use to this episode. It's just so forced and so set up in a fake way. That really the only good thing I can talk about with this episode is just give me more Gleep. Like, give me more him. I would like to see more of him. So that was a bright spot in the episode. There is a big animation error at the beginning of this episode with Skeletor's mouth moving, but it's not him talking. It goes on for like a good 5-10 seconds, so that's not very good. I don't understand why this has no effect on mutants or women. They don't really explain that too much, and this episode is god awful boring.
Pretty much, so. I mean, havoc staff to everybody. I don't know. Like, I didn't write any awards down at all. Like, just so bad, and it's gonna get worse next week. Really is.
Wake me when it's over. I'm going to get my beauty sleep.
So those are, this episode. Oh my god, what did you have for havoc and power and awards?
I just had a power sword for Gleep. Like I said, it was the only good moment for me in this, in the episode, because otherwise this episode was boring. I think this is like the first episode probably in two or three podcasts that we've done, you know, especially during the second half, that I've come down negative on, because I've been pretty positive since we kind of hit the halfway mark, but this was garbage.
Yeah, it really, really was. Rating?
I'm at 1.5 on this one. 1.5.
I'm at a 1.
All right.
There's just too much wrong with this episode.
Yeah, so let's not pay too much attention to this. We'll act like this one didn't happen, take a quick break, and give you our thoughts on the episodes today.
We'll be right back to the new adventures of He-Man.
It's Showtime Synergy. The latest review podcast from the GeekCast Radio Network is here. So join TFG1 Mike, Nicole Hailstorm, and myself, Lady Wreck, as we will be reviewing all 65 episodes of Joe and the Holograms in a 25-episode long podcast. You can find Showtime Synergy on iTunes and GeekCastRadio.com. We are the truly outrageous podcast that you want to be listening to.
Welcome back to the new adventures of He-Man.
We are back here on Masters in Space, Powers of Grayskull series, episode 94.
Creeping our way towards 100.
The downward spiral is starting, folks. We ended this episode on a really, really bad cartoon, and next week it's not going to get any better.
You're showing your hand, sir. It was such a positive, like, halfway point. We've had, like, 5 or 6 good episodes in a row, and I was starting to think, like, oh, the whole second half is going to be what people were talking about when they talk about...
Technical difficulties. Let's move on, shall we?
We are back here on Powers of Grayskull series, Masters in Space, episode 94. And, folks, we ended on a really bad episode today, and it's only going to get worse, I think.
Yeah, you know, we're creeping our way towards 100 here on 94, and I was thinking real positive so far for the second half. Like, we've had, like, I don't know, 3 or 4 podcasts in a row that I've been pretty positive on the episodes, and I was starting to think, like, oh, the second half is what people were talking about when they say, you know, the series is good and this, that, and the other, because I've enjoyed quite a few episodes lately, but maybe it was too good to last. Maybe we're about to go down a bad path.
Yeah, I think we are.
I'm worried.
Yeah. I'm not worried. I'm just waiting for the shoe to just, you know, come slamming into our faces, because holy crap, it's going to.
This was episode 35, so there's only 30 or 36, so we're down to, like, you know, 29 left. Is that what it is?
Something like that. I don't know.
We're over halfway.
Yeah, over halfway. Alright, thank you for listening to the Masters in Space. Today, if you'd like to get in contact with us or leave feedback for the show, there are several ways to do so. Visit the website, geekcastradio.com, where you can comment on this and all of our other episode posts. Leave the show's feedback in iTunes. Please do this. Follow us on Twitter. At Pow of Grayskull is the show Twitter. You can follow at GeekCastRadio for all the other network updates. I am at TFG1Mike. What is your Twitter?
At OptimusSolo.
Become a fan on Facebook. Go to Facebook.com/GeekCastRadioNetwork. We hope you enjoyed the episode today, and don't forget to join us in our next adventure when we will take a look at the next three episodes of The New Adventures of He-Man, which are The Test of Time, Four Ways to Sundown, and The Sheriff of Gorn City. For now, I am TFG1Mike with...
The very worried Optimus Solo.
By the power, for the honor, whatever the hell.
And the magic.
And the magic, and the way, and the weird, and the whatever.
All that.
Yes, all that. Although that has nothing to do with Nickelodeon's all that.
Flawless Ensemble.